All right, brilliant. We are back live. So hopefully people are making their way back to the stream. And well, we're very lucky to have Victor return to the GDSN. So Victor was with us last time, and kind of hinted a little bit at the time, I think, about an impending or incoming bug bounty. And now obviously it's a reality. So Victor, why don't you give your mic check, say hello, and I'll confirm for you.
Hello, everybody, and nice to be at GDSN again. It's a real pleasure for me. And I'll talk to you today about cybersecurity at Parrot and what brought us to Bug Bounty. So just before starting, here we go. I don't know if you see my slide. Yes, you do. It was quite important to explain the whole journey to Bug Bounty because at the end of the day, Bug Bounty is, I wouldn't say kind of an accomplishment, but it's there because we had a few steps before and it makes sense. It makes sense because we did a lot before that. So just before I begin on cybersecurity, just a few information concerning Parrot for those that don't know us. So we design and manufacture small drones, and our latest product is Anaphy USA, which is an awesome drone. Really, it's quite small and it can be impacted less than a minute. It's really quiet, but still it has an awesome capability, and it can zoom 32 times, which means that you can basically see someone at 2 kilometers away and see if that people got a gun or have a precise view of what's happening there. And of course, cybersecurity and trust is also quite important because this drone is made in the US and we had careful choice of components so that it's NDA compliant. So here is basically what's about Anaphy USA, an awesome small drone but very powerful and of course secured. So first, let's talk about security by design. It's not quite easy to define security by design because there can be a lot under this definition. But first, it's important to mention that for us, security by design begins with people. People is quite important because that's them that design the product, develop and implement what's in the product. So security awareness at Parrot is not just a matter of security team. It's really a concept. It's awareness that it's spread across the whole organization from the CEO to product managers to developers. And basically, everybody is aware of cybersecurity. And to me, that's one of the main points. It's quite important that people get involved, that people understand what are the security need and understand that it's important to protect clients' data. So for me, it works first because people are there. People are really have a wide range of skill sets at Parrot, and among those skill sets, they get better and better at understanding security and implementing security. So that's the first point, and this allows us to implement security from the beginning of projects. You know, there's many products for which cybersecurity is kind of an add-on. It's done afterward, sometime at the end of the development of a product, or even from times to times after it's out on the market. And it's quite different at Parrot because cybersecurity is there from the beginning. And when we start a project, we wonder what is the real need and what we have to improve into that product compared to previous ones. So as far as it's a priority for Parrot, we define it just the same way that we would define that a drone would have to fly for this amount of time and would have to see with this amount of zoom or thermal capability and so on. So cybersecurity is there and it's there from the beginning. And cybersecurity is not just a matter of implementing it in-house at Parrot. It's important to have this broad view and global view and to include all suppliers and especially all the supply chain that provides some components or from time to time help us to implement part of the software. So concerning this supply chain, we've seen in the past a few products in the electronic consumers part that are that might be backdoored or may have huge vulnerabilities. So it's quite important at Parrot that we check what is the level of security of the different suppliers, and we make sure that we trust where the components come from. So that was a real need for NDA compliance and for Blue SOS program for Anafi USA, but it's now part of the way we do things. So it's a great improvement also. And of course, when we speak about security by design, it's important to do it at the very beginning and define what the security needs is and what the different security features will be, then implement, but also check. And that's what we will focus on when we speak about audits and bug bounty, because this part is quite important. And this cycle helps us to implement continuous security improvements, which means that over time, be it for one product and also from product to future products, we continuously improve cybersecurity, which means that in the previous years, we've done a lot so far, but we won't stop there and we will continue to keep integrating even more security and protect users' data always better, so that we make sure that we minimize the potential impact of a defect if one day there's one. So here are some examples of questions we could ask ourselves when we design a product. And by the way, that's also that kind of question that clients ask to Parrot just to understand how we implement security. So when we've got a drone, most of people would wonder how we authenticate and encrypt the radio link between the remote controller and the drone. They would understand how we protect the user data that is stored on the drone and how we would protect the drone itself, because it's important that no attacker could put a malicious software into the drone. And for some people, it's also quite important to protect flight data, for example, from forensic analysis. Because if a drone is lost or caught by an adverse party, you may not want this adverse party to understand where you took off, where you've been flying for this mission or for previous missions. So it's important also, especially for defense and sometimes for public safety, to also protect this kind of data. So once we've defined the security need, of course, we implement solutions. So here are just a few examples of those solutions. So if you wonder how we authenticate and encrypt the radio link between the remote controller and the drone, So basically, we use a standard WPA2 protocol, and we define for each pair of drone and remote controller a unique key. So first, the fact that there's a unique key makes it secure by default, because there's no default password that an attacker could guess or could reuse very easily. But then that's not the only thing we define, because even if it's unique by default, the user can define its own just to make sure it is a password and not just one defined by Parrot. If you wonder how we protect data that is stored on the drone, so that's one of the best enhancements on ANAFI USA. We implement a full disk encryption on the SD card. So basically all photos and videos taken by the drone is stored into this SD card. And we don't encrypt data file by file, but the whole disk is encrypted. And that's great because it allows to protect every data, and it also prevents some forensics techniques that would be used, for example, to retrieve just one data or try to intercept part of the data before it's encrypted. Mm-hmm. So here, everything is encrypted, and we use best-in-class algorithms, just to name it, AES XTS with 512-bit key lengths. And what's quite important is that we don't stick to marketing cybersecurity. We also implemented the right way. For example, with XTS, we choose the right block mode of operation. We choose the longest possible key length. And the most important thing is that we make sure that this key is never stored on the drone. Because if the drone is lost, someone could try to retrieve this key. And here it's completely different, because to make it secure, we have this key that is stored into the software that is in the remote controller. And when it's paired to the drone, the remote controller transmits the key to the drone in a secure manner. This key is never written into the drone. So it's never written to disk and only used on volatile memory, which means that if the drone is lost, as far as access to the volatile memory is protected, as far as the drone is switched off, everything is just lost, and nobody can retrieve the key that would allow an attacker to decrypt data. So it's important not just to stick to the security features, but also to implement it the right way. So just to continue to the different questions. So if you wonder how to ensure the embedded system integrity and make sure that no attacker would put a malicious software into the drone, so what's quite important is that first we harden the system so that there's no remote access to the embedded system and no way to connect to the operating system. But then when the software evolves, the drone makes sure that there's a legit digital signature before applying a firmware update. So doing that, we make sure that this firmware really comes from Parrot, and we make sure that if an attacker tried to modify just one bit, the attacker won't be able to push this update, because the drone would notice that there's one bit difference, which would make the digital signature invalid and the update disregarded. So that's one of the examples of the way we protect the system. And finally, how do we protect flight data from forensics analysis? So it's not implemented on all versions of drones, but for security additions, which mean governmental use, we have additional anti-forensics techniques that prevent an attacker from accessing flight data, return to home or return to position, and any data that the drone would have to keep in memory during the flight, just so that things go well. So it's important because we could say there's no data stored on the drone, but when the flight, you're during the flight, you need some data. For example, if you lose the radio link between the remote controller and the drone has a return to home, or you could even define a return to position. So you define a position before takeoff, so that the drone won't come back to you, but to a defined position, so that an adverse party won't guess where you are. So if you want to protect all those data, you have to make sure that nothing is written to disk and data is protected, so that no one can retrieve this. And last, concerning data, of course, we can fly our drones with no internet connection. And there's a way to put firmware updates completely offline and import maps offline. And there's no mechanism to unlock fly in no-fly zones. So, for example, if you're a cop, and you need to fly in an airport because let's say there's a terrorist attack and you need to fly into this space, there's no need for you to say, hey, I'm a cop, and ask to pirate the ability to fly in this zone. So we think that pilots have to be responsible and won't don't have to necessarily really ask to pirate to have the right to fly when they need to. So basically, you don't need any internet connection, nor during the flight, nor before the flight. You can do just everything offline, which is quite different from some competitors, because they say you can do this or this offline, but in one step or another, at the end of the day, you need some kind of connection. During the beginning of the presentation, I was speaking about continuous improvement. So it's quite important for us to see the future and to implement always better cybersecurity. So last year, we announced a partnership with WISeKey, which is a provider of secure elements. And this will have a great place into implementing security in our next models of drones. So it's a great component because it helps the drone to keep some information secrets. So it's just like a safe. And it also computes some cryptographic functions in a secure manner. So this way, we make sure that this information stays secret and is computing the right way. So this, I guess we will be able to speak about this into greater details quite soon. So we've been speaking about security by design, and you've seen that from security awareness and the importance of people, from the way we implement security from the beginning, and then from the way we look at great details to implement security the right way. So there's a whole cycle that helps us to implement good security, but that's not the end of the day. And beside this, it's really important for pirates to be quite transparent, because we know that for our customers, the more transparency, the more they'll trust our solutions. And the way everything is crystal clear and powered being transparent, we can explain how security works and how data are protected and how communication works. And this level of transparency is really important for trust. So for example, in our application, we chose not to obfuscate anything into our softwares. We don't have any hidden features. So compared to what's been found in other solutions, here we have full transparency. And whenever we can, we use standard protocols and standard file formats. So this can be for security, such as WPA2 or for video communications, as well as file formats such as Gutma, which is a file format used for flight logs for drone operations. And this use of standard protocols is quite important for security, because then it makes it possible to verify security. So let's imagine that you've got a drone for which the manufacturer provides an encrypted protocol for communication between the remote controller and the drone, but say, don't worry, it's secured, but it's proprietary, so you won't know how it works. So that's not good security, because you can't check it's done the right way. And they could use a few marketing buzzwords, such as say, hey, okay, it's encrypted with AES 256. And if you're not aware of cryptography, you may say, hey, okay, that's a good standard and that's a good algorithm. So as far as I understand, I would trust this. But then if you go into details, you can see that the way it's implemented, the way you may have session keys, the way you use block mode of operations into encryption, there's many details for which security could fail. And because it's proprietary, you won't be able to verify it's done the right way. So here for Parrot, it's quite important for us to use standard protocols, because first it helps interoperability, but then it also helps all of our clients to verify it's done the right way. So we also have an open SDK, so you can interact with our drone with an open software development kit. This is the secure exchange of information between the drone and other software platforms, SaaS solutions, cloud, and everything. Just two words about privacy. It's important to speak about security, but privacy is also quite important for Parrot. And the transparency I just mentioned is quite important for privacy. And so first, we don't collect any data by default. So when a user flights a Parrot drone, no data is shared by default, but still a user can choose whether or not he will store data online. So we only speak about flight data here. And what's important for data processing transparency is that when you look at our privacy policy, it's quite clear why this data might be processed. So for example, concerning flight data, it can be useful for the user to store it on Parrot servers, so that he can synchronize data between one device and another device. So for example, between a smartphone, a tablet and a computer, so that whatever device the user will use, he will access to the flight data about current and previous flights. But this same data is also potentially useful for customer support, and it may be useful for Pirate to enhance products. And at the end of the day, it's important to understand the different purpose for which data can be useful, because then within the organization, this data might be widespread between the server that allows a user to synchronize data, or to the servers that are used by customer support, or to different systems that are used by research and development teams to make products even better. So if you consider this, it might be difficult to make sure that users keep control over all this data, even if it's widespread among different services into the organization. And what we did is that we have a global governance of data, and just by one click into the mobile application, a user can decide if he asks for data deletions. And we have a global scheduler that will give the order to every internal server to erase this specific data. So it's quite important, because it's not just a matter of opt-in or opt-out to receive marketing emails, or even at one point in time to share data. Using this, we have privacy by design, because for every copy, for every piece of information that belongs to the user keeps control and can choose whether or not this data can be deleted or not. So here is basically where you can find it into the app. So that was the first part about what we do in terms of cybersecurity and privacy. But once you've defined cybersecurity and designed it the good way, once you've implemented this, it's also quite important to check it's been done the right way, and you didn't forget anything, and there's no error in the way it's been done. So here we have a global framework which is quite complementary, and we benefit from both internal audits, external audits, and audit by clients. So basically, internal audits are those audits done by Pirate staffs. So basically, that's what I've been doing part of my time, because previously, I was a cybersecurity auditor, and I did a lot of penetration testings. So it helps Parrot to see if something was done the wrong way and what we have to announce. So that's a first step. But then we have complementary steps and especially external assessments. So there might be different ones, but the one we communicated about last year was one audit by Bishop Fox. And the assessment team really go deep into details. First, because the perimeter was wide enough, because there was into this perimeter both the mobile applications that control the drone, but also the different web services with which the application speaks. And we did both source code assessment as well as penetration testing, just to make sure that we stick to the attacker's point of view. And it's important to mention that there's no complacency here and no strong limitation compared to other competitors that use that kind of audits for marketing purposes. But when you look at the results, they say, Okay, there's an audit, but we had quite limited time and quite limited skill sets. And by the way, there was no reverse engineering skills among the team, and that was not the purpose. And when you add all the limitations, you see that basically the audit was kind of useless. But then the conclusion of the audit is, oh, okay, there was lots of limitations, but we found nothing. But it's not relevant here. So what we do at Parrot is that we choose the best audit teams with the best skill sets, and we make sure that they've got everything. They can benefit from our source code. They can look to whatever they want. So they define what is useful and what's the good level of verification. So important to see it allows them to deep dive and to look to great details into our solutions. And because we have more and more clients for which cybersecurity is a key point, those clients are also doing additional audits. So we've benefited from many audits from clients, be that in the defense space or public safety, or even in the industry. So there's many professionals that are more and more aware of cybersecurity and are aware that if they want to operate drones, they have to operate it in a secure manner. So they are doing their own audits. And it's great for us because it allows us to validate every piece of work we've done before and to make sure it's been done the right way. And of course, one big part of the audits was the Blue SUS program. So as you may know, we've got the great chance at Parrot to be among the five manufacturer which are selected in the United States for trusted drones that may be used for governmental or any sensitive purpose. So during this process, there was audit teams both on the Defense Innovation Unit side and on the users side that checked for security, both on the software part, but also concerning the supply chain and the different components we selected, and the probabilities that depending on the source of those components, there might be security considerations. So as you may see, checking security is just it's not only one solution, but doing it the right way is the addition of different steps and the way we do different audits. But then doing all of this, we wondered what we could do better, and we came to Bug Bounty. So we'll see precisely why we did that and what the difference between the audits and Bug Bounty. So first, we partner with Yes We Hack, which is the first European bug bounty platform. So we chose Yes We Hack for two reasons. So first, as far as it's the first European platform, they benefit from the wider number of security researchers or security hunters. So that's quite important because that helps the platform to have the wider skill sets and the more people that look at cybersecurity, the better. The other reason is that as we are a European manufacturer, it was easier for us to organize things with a European partner because concerning drones, it's not just a matter of checking cybersecurity on a website or a web service. It's also important for us to provide drones to security researchers and we define a mix of public and private bug bounty programs. And for part of the private bug bounty programs, we use that to test future products, which means that we select a few security researchers that are among those that are the more skilled on the platform, and also those that we trust, because then we'll give them products that are not already on the market. So we have to make sure that we trust those security researchers. And then they look at potential security vulnerabilities before the product is out, which of course benefits to our clients, because even before the solutions are on the market, we make sure that they've got the right level of security and that nothing was forgotten or any error in the way we implement things. So that, to me, that helps us to be even more transparent and to give always more assurance to our consumers, so that they can make sure that when we say we've got trusted drones and cyber-secured drones, it's not just words, it's based on facts. So one of the most important thing is the difference from audit and bug bounty. And we can see here that each solution has benefits and drawbacks. So for example, the main difference between audits and bug bounty is the perimeter and the limitation in time or in versions that you may have for audits. So if it, of course, a drone would evolve over time and all the time we make better software and we implement new features into the drone. So even for the same drone, the software may evolve over time. So when we do an audit, we know if there's potential vulnerabilities on this version at this precise time. But the main difference with bug bounty is that you can cover a wider perimeter and you can have continuous testing, because it's not based on a specific time frame, but you can have it all over the year. And if someone finds something, maybe it was an old bug, but it may be also something what was introduced during development on a brand new feature. And then it's quite useful to benefit from the expertise of security researchers that can look at modifications and do that in a continuous way. So for me, that's the main reason for which we decided to go to bug bounty compared to audits. It helps Parrot to have security checking, not just on defined steps, but all the time. Concerning the perimeter, we also saw that we focused on actual drones or future model of drones and the way they are secured. But seeing how security researchers participating to bug bounty works, they work just the way an attacker would do. And they also look at older solutions. So for example, Parrot has been doing drones for more than 10 years, and we may have cloud services to retrieve logs from older drones at a time that cybersecurity was not at the same level with the same needs. And most of the times at that time, Parrot was mostly doing toys and not drones for professionals. So having this wider perimeter, we can benefit from better security for all products, not just those from today, but also those that were sold something like 5 years ago and didn't have the same level of security compared to those we provide today. So the way that we base this analysis on a wide range of researchers that have better skill sets, because the number here is quite important. When you think about cybersecurity, it's not just one field of application. Cybersecurity is quite wide. And when you think about cybersecurity and the skill set needed for cybersecurity, you can see that some security professionals are really good at understanding the network and the way that network protocols can be misused or can be protected. You can see that other security experts really do know how to secure a mobile application or a web service. And you'll see that other security professionals are really good at securing an embedded system or attacking an embedded systems. And there's a wide range of skill sets. And at the end of the day, there's no way that one or two auditors can have all the skills that may be needed for a wide and global view on cybersecurity. And all the times you may have one, two, or even 5 or 10 auditors, you'll be always limited to those skills they have at the time of the audit. The great benefit with Bug Bounty is that you benefit from all the skills from hundreds or thousands of security researchers, and all of them is really good at something, but the fact that we benefit from the sum of all of those skill sets make it a good complementary view. So that's basically the main difference between audit and bug bounty in favor of bug bounty. You also have to be aware of some of the drawbacks. And for example, it's most of the time easier to go into details with auditors compared to bug bounty. And for example, what we did with Bishop Fox, we shared source code. We spent weeks and weeks, if not months, to exchange with them so that they first have a global view and then go into details of one thing and another. And that needs a lot of work, and that needs a lot of exchanges so that they can understand everything of what we do, the way we do it, and to check we do it the right way. If we compare to bug bounty, most of security researchers that participate to bug bounty look at easier solutions, and of course they stick to the way that an attacker would proceed, but sometimes with more superficial view. So that's one of the drawback. And another drawback is that with bug bounty, you have to do more triage, which means that you've got maybe a few reports, and among those reports, let's say over 10 reports, there's one or two that are really important and you may have something to do better. But for others, you may have reports for hypothetical vulnerabilities that may have absolutely no impact on real confidentiality or integrity or availability of information. So it may be hard for a security researcher participating to bug bounty to understand the drone market, to understand what security needs we have. And it's easier to have that kind of exchanges with security auditors. So just to sum up, bug bounty is not an all-in-one solution. it's really complementary, and that's why I wanted to speak to you about security by design, the different steps and the way we implement security, the way we check it. And at the end of the day, Bug Bounty is relevant just because we add the previous steps and we did security by design, and then we first checked with audits. If we did not do that, I guess we would have tens and tens of reports within the Bug Bounty, and that we would be really hard to manage. But here, because we did all those previous steps, we have something that is complementary and just helps us to make sure that we didn't forget anything, and then there's no an old function that may have a default or anything like that. So it's quite important to have both and not just Bug Bounty. So it's basically it, and I guess we may have questions now.
Yes, I'm joining you now. So thank you very much for that, Victor. Appreciate the presentation.
Welcome.
Okay, so we do have quite a few about the Bug Bounty, obviously, and I'll try to get through them. But I think the very first one, without just thinking about the Bug Bounty side, was what is the drone security job demand like currently?
Not sure to get your question precisely.
Okay, so what is, do you think the demand for security within drones is increasing to the point of people getting jobs in drone security?
First, I think that on the client side, there's more and more clients that get aware that security is a prerequisite, and they need cybersecurity to operate drones. And I think it's a big change because I'd say 3 or 4 years ago, most people wouldn't even ask for security, and they wouldn't have the idea to say, I need a secure drone. And nowadays, we see that security makes a real difference because you have devices that can capture really sensitive data and can be used for sensitive operation, be that for public safety, defense, or even inspection or mapping on critical infrastructures or things like that. And when you do that, you do need cybersecurity. It's not just an option. If you don't have cybersecurity, you can't conduct your operations. So as far as you or clients, users really do need cybersecurity, I think it will be a broader topic today and in the future. And of course, that's a priority for Parrot, but that's also why I said that it's continuous improvement, because for cybersecurity, you can just get to sleep and say, okay, I did the job and now that's done, I won't do anything more. Attackers will always have new ideas. There will always be vulnerabilities in software components. If that's not my components, it might be a component with which drone interact and with which drone can exchange data. And drones will be used in a more and more autonomous way, and you'll have more and more connectivity on drones and more ingestion of data captured by drones sent to other softwares. And the more you go to this open world, and the more drones will be used for professional or security uses, and the more you need cybersecurity. So I'm quite sure that in the next months and years, there will always be more and more a job for cybersecurity in drones.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well summarized. Okay. And we'll continue with some of the bug bounty questions. So one of them says, is the bug bounty you are conducting only oriented to software, or do you also do hardware security? And I think this is probably the public-private part of it.
Yeah, actually, it's both, and the main difference between public and private is that within the private bug bounty, it's easier to organize the way we can provide a drone to security researcher compared to public, which is not possible at all. So public is good for web services, mobile applications that are available right away. It can also be done on part of the security features that can be tested with a simulator. And that's why also I mentioned that at Parrot, we have this transparent way of doing things, and we provide a lot of tools to understand the drone and to simulate the drone, and it's really useful. Not just for cybersecurity, of course, but for everything you may do with a drone. And doing this simulator, it emulates a drone's firmware completely. So any security researcher, without buying a drone, can also test the drone even in a public bug bounty program. But then, the more you go into details, concerning the hardware, and the more useful the private programs of our bug bounty will be, and it's especially the case concerning the secure element I spoke about just before, because that's a security component that can be emulated or nothing like that. And of course, you need the electronic board and the hardware to test that. So really, we do both. But we can do both at the same level because concerning the hardware, we have to select a few security researchers, and we can't make that public, of course.
Okay, makes sense. And look, we might have some more short answer questions that are specific to the bug bounty as well. The one is the private program open to people outside of Europe?
Yes, and for example, yesterday I answered to a security researcher that is from India, so it's quite open. So the way it works is that for the moment we have mostly private programs, even for actual products, and those private programs helps us to improve the process between the bug bounty platform and Parrot internal staff, and to make sure that it's the more fluid and everything goes well. So in a few weeks we'll have full public bug bounty programs concerning this perimeter, and in parallel we'll open more private programs with that are focused on future products. But only on private programs.
Okay.
But on both sides, we can have a mix of European and worldwide researchers. And yes, React is the first European platform, but of course, there's a lot of Americans, there's a lot of Asians or Africans researchers. So there's no problem at all to have all those products. And we chose a European platform just because it's easier for us with this platform to organize the way we ship products to some researchers. So that was just more convenient, but it's absolutely not a limit concerning the kind of people that can go to the platform and enroll to those platform. So if you're a security researcher, just enroll to Yes React, and you can even speak with me in private and say you'd like to join a private program, and we'll see what we can do, but it's possible.
Okay, brilliant. And I think we'll go on to one last kind of dual question here before we take a break and thank you. And that is, have you seen any surprising submissions yet? And what is the price ranges for payouts that Parrot has offered?
Actually, the price range depends on the perimeter because we have different programs on different perimeters, but it can go from a few hundreds for low impact vulnerabilities to a few thousands for higher impact. And you'll know more about the scale of rewards once we have public programs, which should be in a few weeks. And as of today, I haven't had that much reports, and a few of them was quite interesting. So it helped us improve our whole infrastructures and softwares. So for the moment, it was quite useful to have this bug bounty program, even if there's no catastrophic discovery for the moment.
Yeah, well, that's always good news. So brilliant. Victor, thank you for coming on again. Thank you for your presentation. And we enjoy the transparency that you're able to give and the focus that you have as a company on drone security. So thank you very much. And I hope everyone will join me in applauding Victor for his talk. So thank you.
You're welcome. And maybe see you at next GDSM.
Exactly, that's right. Maybe three times lucky. So, okay, thank you, everyone. And we will be back in roughly 4 minutes for our talk with Kim James.